Good morning. Before I start, I would like to introduce myself first. I am Rafael Diaz, and I'll be the first one to present for our group. Now, our group will be discussing one of the wonderful application of matrices in our daily lives, and that is linear programming. Now, with my report, I'll be discussing some examples, okay, of linear programming problems, and we'll be also talking about geometric solution, feasible religion, and feasible solution. So later on, we'll be able to identify those terms. But first, let us have a brief background what linear programming is. So when we hear the word programming, it seems that we are talking about computers, okay, or computer programs, but it's different from that. Because when we talk about programming in linear programming, we are talking about a course of action, okay? Because here, our goal is to identify a way, okay, the best way, okay, to solve a specific problem, because we need to be careful with the variables that we will use in every problem. So later on, you'll be able to understand what I'm talking about, okay? Now, actually, linear programming dates back in 1940s, wherein mathematicians during that time were asked to solve some federal problems for the federal government. And some notable mathematicians during that time were Kantorovich, Leonid, and George Danzig. Generally, when we talk about linear programming, it seeks to maximize or minimize a linear function subject to a set of linear constraints or restrictions. Now, as we go on with our problems later, we'll be able to identify what is the meaning of this one, okay? So, let's start first with some components that we need to take into consideration in every linear programming problem. So, first, we need to have a set of decision variables, an objective function, and a set of constraints. Now, when we try to solve each linear programming problem, we'll be able to identify these three components. So let's start with the first problem. Okay, the farmer's problem. Let me do this very quick. Suppose that a farmer has 240 hectares of land. The farmer can earn a profit of 40 pesos per hectare of corn and 30 per hectare of oat. Now, the farmer has only 320 hours available. Now, if planting corn takes 2 hours of labor per hectare, while planting oat takes 1 hour of labor, how many hectares of each should be planted to maximize profits? Okay. So first, let us identify the decision variables. Now, there are some books that use the variables X and Y, but there are also some books that uses X sub 1 and X sub 2. So for this one, I'll be using X and Y to represent our decision variables. Now let X be the number of hectares of corn, while Y be the number of hectares of oat. Next, we set our objective function. So our objective function is the function that is desired to maximize or minimize. Okay, but for this one, we will identify the value that will maximize that objective function, since we are looking for that in this problem. Since that a farmer can earn a profit of 40 per hectare, so that is 40 times X for corn, then 30 per hectare of oat, so that is 30 times Y. It can be represented by this objective function, Z is equal to 40X plus 30Y. So this is our objective function. So later we'll identify the maximum value, okay, as we plug in values of X and Y in this objective function. So the next one is we need to take into consideration some restrictions. The first one is X and Y cannot be negative because we cannot have negative number of hectares of corn and oat. So it can be represented by X is greater than or equal to 0, same thing with Y. Next, the farmer has only 240 hectares of land, so we cannot go beyond that. Okay, So we can we'll have this inequality x plus y should be less than or equal to 240. Also, we have only 320 hours available of labor. But for corn, it takes 2 hours of labor, while for oat, it takes 1 hour of labor. So it can be represented by this inequality. 2x, okay, or 2 times x plus y should be less than or equal to 320 hours. Okay, so to represent that mathematically, okay, we need to find the values of x and y that will maximize this objective function. Okay, subject to the following restrictions that must be satisfied by x and y. So, there you go. But for now, we'll stop there. Later, we'll solve for the values of x and y because later, we'll be identifying a way how to solve for the values of x and y. So, bibitinin ko muna kayo. So, let's have the next problem. Okay, so the photocopier problem. So, here's the problem. It's a little bit long. So, I'll just ask you to read them on your handouts. Okay? So, let's just proceed to the solution. Okay, so the first thing to do is we need to identify our, yes, decision variables. So, let x and y be the number of reams of bond paper printed in photocopier A and photocopier B, respectively. So, x will be photocopier A, and then B, y will be photocopier B. Now, according to this problem, okay, the owner can should produce at least 60 reams per day. So, it will be given by this inequality. So, x plus y should be greater than or less than or equal to 60. Okay. Now, also for photocopier A, it can only produce at most 40 reams per day. Okay, so it can be represented by this inequality. X should be less than or equal to 40. And for photocopier B, it can only produce at most 50 reams. So we cannot go beyond those number of reams. Also, x and y cannot be negative. So, x should be greater than or equal to 0. Same thing with y. And for our objective function, okay, the number of damaged sheets of bond paper were counted and found to be 20 sheets of bond paper for photocopier A and 30 sheets for photocopier B. So, this is our objective function because for this problem, okay, we need to identify the minimum value, okay, or the least number of total amount of damaged sheets of bond paper for each photocopying machine. So it can be represented by this equation, z is equal to 20 sheets times x, which is photocopier A, and then 30 sheets, okay, for photocopier B, times y, that is photocopier B. So to represent that mathematically, okay, we need to find the values that will minimize this objective function subject to the following restrictions. Okay, so let's stop there again. Let's just proceed to the next problem. So the next problem is the supplement problem. So it's also a little bit long. Just read it on your handout. Okay. So, let x be the number of capsules of supplement A to be produced, and y be the number of capsules supplement B to be produced. Now, first, we need to identify the constraints or the restriction for vitamin A. Note that for vitamin A, okay, supplement A contains 2 milligrams, so that is 2 times x, while for supplement B, it contains only 1 milligram, so that is y. And we have only at least 12 milligrams of vitamin A to be produced. So it can be represented by this inequality. So 2x plus y should be greater than or equal to 12 because we must have at least 12 milligrams of vitamin A per capsule. Okay. Okay, next, for vitamin C, okay, x plus y should be greater than or equal to 9. Okay, because for supplement A, we should have a 1 milligram of vitamin C. And for supplement B, we have also 1 milligram of vitamin C. And we should have at least 9 milligrams of vitamin C. Okay. Also, for zinc, okay, we should have 1 milligram of zinc for supplement A and 3 milligrams of zinc for supplement B. Where's that? Supplement B. There. Okay. And we should, zinc, we should have at least 15 milligrams of zinc. Okay, so those are our first set of restrictions or constraints. Also, we cannot have a negative value for X and Y. So it can be represented by this inequality. And for our objective function, we need to identify how many capsules of each type of supplement should be produced to minimize the cost. Wherein, okay, supplement A costs 30 pesos, so that is the 30x, while supplement B costs 40, so that is 40 times Y. So it can be represented by this inequality, 30x plus 40y is equal to Z. Okay? To represent that mathematically, we need to find the values of X and Y that will minimize this objective function. And taking into considerations that B, that X and Y should satisfy these restrictions there. Okay, so now, how to solve this kind of problems or this linear programming problems? If you will observe the preceding examples, okay, these are actually examples of general linear programming problems. And it is similar to this one. We need to find the values of X and Y that will maximize or minimize. Z is equal to C sub 1X plus C sub 2 times Y. So these are our constants depending on the problem. And we have, and this is what we call as the objective function. Okay. So the objective function tells us or wants us to identify the values of X and Y that will maximize or minimize this one. Okay, now subject two, okay, a set of constraints. Now these are what we call as regular constraints, okay, because also we have another set of constraints or restrictions which is represented by these two. These are what we call as non-negativity constraints, because as you observe, we cannot have a negative value for X and Y. So generally, this is an example of a linear programming problem. Okay. Now take note that for the regular constraints, it can be less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, or simply equal to. So now, let's try to identify the solution for the problems a while ago. So we'll use what we call as the geometric solution. Now for the geometric solution method, we need to identify the following. The first one is the feasible solution, the feasible region, and the optimal solution. Now later on, as we go on with the problems, okay, we'll be able to identify what are these three. Okay, so now we will now show how to solve linear programming problems in two variables, graphically or geometrically. Okay, so first, these are the graph of the non-negativity constraints. So as you observe, we always have this in our linear programming problems. So using the half plane graph of inequalities, so X should be greater than or equal to 0. So this is the shaded part. While for Y, it should be greater than or equal to 0. So this is the shaded part. Combining the two, okay, this gives us the intersection of the half-plane regions of these two inequalities. Okay. So as you observe, usually we should have the possible solutions here. Okay. Now let's try to solve the geometric solution for the linear programming, for the first linear programming problem, and it's given by this one. Okay. So, first, our goal is to graph all the inequalities or the restrictions this. So, we have four inequalities. So, first, okay, we have y should be greater than or equal to 0, this one. Okay. Next is x should be greater than or equal to 0. So, this is the shaded part. Next, okay, x plus y should be less than or equal to 240. So, that's the shaded part. And then, for this inequality, 2x plus y should be less than or equal to 320. Now, as you can see, there is an intersection with these shaded regions. And this is this one. Now, this is what we call as the feasible region. Now, the feasible region contains set of x and y's, okay, that can be possible solutions for our objective function. So, the solutions that we can get here are what we call as the feasible solutions. This includes all the points inside this feasible region together with the points on this border, okay, of this region. Okay, so everything inside here and all the points that we have here on the borders of this region are what we call as feasible solutions. But the question is, okay, which feasible solutions should we use? We have actually infinitely number of feasible solutions inside this, okay, region. Now, we can actually just consider these points, or what we call as extreme points. If you observe, these are actually the vertices, or vertices, okay, of the feasible region. Okay, now why? The question is, why these points? Okay. Why should we use these points? Now, according to this theorem, okay, about maximum and minimum values, let me read it very quick. If the feasible region of a linear programming problem is non-empty and bounded, then the objective function attains both maximum and minimum value. And this occurs at extreme points of the feasible region. If the feasible region is unbounded, then the objective function may or may not attain a maximum or minimum value. If it attains maximum or minimum value, it does so at extreme point, at an extreme point. Now, to give you a proof for this one, okay, it can be shown by this graph. Okay, since the objective of the objective function z is equal to c sub 1 x plus c sub 2 y, okay, of a linear program problem is a linear function x and y, its level curves, so these are the level curves, okay, along which these curves along which z has constant values, and these are straight lines. Now, as we move on into this direction of this level curves perpendicularly, either by this one or by this one, okay, z decreases or increases. Now, this means that within a bounded feasible region, the maximum and minimum values of z therefore occurs on the extreme points, like these two points. Okay, so this is the only proof that I was able to find, okay, for the theorem a while ago. So that theorem is actually very important because it will guide us, okay, how to get the the feasible solutions for our objective function. Now, going back to our problem a while ago, now, these are what we call as the feasible solutions, okay? These are the possible feasible solutions or the extreme points. Now, let us try to identify the coordinates of each point. Okay, so for this point A, which is 0, 0, or simply the intersection of this inequality and this inequality, and then this point B is equal to, point B is 160, 0. So that's the intersection of this inequality and this inequality, or simply the x-intercept of this inequality when we convert it into an equation. And then this point is the intersection of these two inequalities, or simply getting the solution of these two inequalities when we convert them into equations. And that point D, 0, 240. Okay, or the y-intercept of this inequality when we convert it into an equation. Now, so those are the points. So these are the possible, okay, solutions or feasible solutions. Now, our goal is just plug in the values of x and y here into our objective function. And let's have the first one. So, of course, this, if x is 0, this will become 0. If y is 0, this will become 0. Now, if x is 160, so 40 times 60, 160 times 40 is 6,400, and this will be cancelled. Now, for this one, if x is 40, if x is 80 times 40 plus 160 times 30 will give us this value. Same thing with this one. Now, as you can see, we have the maximum value on this point. So, this is what we call as the optimal solution. Now, the optimal solution can be the minimum value or the maximum value. So, it depends in the problem. So, for this one, since our goal is to identify the maximum profit of the farmer, so this will serve as our optimal solution. So, meaning to say, if the farmer plants 80 hectares of corn and then 160 hectares of oats, okay, he can attain the maximum profit, okay, which is 8,000 pesos. So, this is an example of a geometric solution for the linear programming problem that we had a while ago. Okay? Now, let's try to do the same thing with linear programming problem number 2. So, we have this set of restrictions and objective function. Next, we need to graph it, and this is the graph. And as you can see, okay, the intersection of the half planes, okay, is on this one. Okay? Now, according to the theorem, okay, if it's a bounded feasible region, okay, we can say that the extreme points are our feasible solutions. Okay, so the coordinates of each point are given by this one. So same thing, we just plug in these points to our objective function for this problem. And as you can see, okay, we got the smallest value of z at this point. Okay, so meaning to say, this will serve as our optimal solution. Because our goal for this problem is to identify the minimum value of number of rings for photocopier A and photocopier B. Okay, so that we can get the minimum value of wasted number of sheets. So this is the optimal solution. Okay, next, let's have problem number 3. Okay, now here's the graph. Now, if you observe, okay, so this is the shaded region or the intersection of the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 inequalities. Now, as you can see, it's not a bounded region, or it's actually unbounded region. Okay, so there. So it's not a bounded solution. Now, some books says that if we have an unbounded feasible region, we can stop there. So there is no possible solution for this one. But there are some books that suggest that since, okay, the feasible solution can be attained, okay, at the extreme points, we can actually use these points, okay, to identify a possible optimal solution for this problem. So we just get the coordinates of each point, okay, and then plug in to our objective function. And for this one, we need to identify the minimum cost. Okay, and it seems that when x is 6 and y is 3, we will have the minimum value, okay, of say which is 300. Now this is a possible solution, but since that our theorem says that it cannot assure that this is the possible solution, okay, some books will say that we can stop there, okay, but some books, okay, we can try to use this extreme points so that we can show a possible solution for a linear programming problem. So for this one, this may be a possible solution for this problem. Okay. Next, now let's try to have another linear programming problem. Okay, given by this objective function and then this restrictions, and let's try to graph it. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 inequalities. Now the shaded region is located here. Okay, so this is our feasible region, meaning to say our feasible solutions are there, and by the theorem we can use the extreme points, okay, as possible optimal solution for our for this one. Okay, so we just do the same thing. Okay, we plug in the points to this objective function, but if you observe, okay, we have equal possible answer for z here, okay, wherein if x is 9 and y is 2, same thing with this one, if x is 3 and y is 6, we'll get the same thing, 48. So for this linear programming problem, okay, we have two optimal solutions, since our goal here is to find the, okay, the maximum value or to maximize this objective function. So our optimal solutions are these two points. Okay, so that is also possible that we can have one or more optimal solutions as long that they have the same value for z. Okay, now let's try to have this one. Our last problem, okay, given by this objective function and these constraints. Okay, so we need to identify the maximum value. By graphing the inequalities, if you observe, okay, so this is the shaded part of this inequality, this is the shaded part of this inequality, there is no intersection with the shaded with the regions. And for this one, we don't have a feasible region. So meaning to say, there is no feasible solution for this problem. Meaning to say, the inequalities are inconsistent because there is no possible value for x and y, okay, to satisfy all the regular constraints or all these linear inequalities. So for this one, there's no feasible solution. So, to sum it up, so our procedure to identify the optimal solutions in a feasible region. So first, we need to formulate the linear programming problem, graph the constraints and the constraint inequalities, identify the feasible region which satisfies all constraints simultaneously, meaning to say we need to identify the intersecting region of all the half planes of the inequalities, and then we need to locate the extreme points of the feasible region, because according to the theorem, these extreme points will serve as our, okay, possible optimal solutions. Okay, now also we need to evaluate the objective function at each of the extreme points, and from that we will just choose, okay, at what point we can have a maximum or a minimum value. So it depends on the problem. Also, we can generalize that a linear programming problem can have more than one optimal solution. Okay, it can have only one optimal solution or more than one. It can also have no maximum value or no minimum value if it's unbounded. But since the theorem says that we can use the extreme points, the extreme points given by the graph to give us a possible solution for that specific problem. Also, if there is no feasible solution, that is There are no points satisfying all the constraints. Okay, so that will be all. And have a great day. Bye.
Stop.